Okay, good afternoon everybody. You're very welcome to this edition of the ESB lecture series, lecture entitled Smart Networks for the Energy Transition. I'm Fergal McNamara and I'm going to try to chair this session today, and I'm really delighted to welcome to the Institute Professor Nikos Hatziargyriou. Nikos, you're very welcome. Nikos is the chair of the European Technology Platform for Smart Networks, the Energy Transition. He is also the chairman of HEDNO, which is the Greek distribution system operator, the equivalent of our ESB networks, and he's also a professor at the National Technical University of Athens. From ESB's perspective, this is part of the ESB lecture series, and we're delighted to be associated with the Institute and delighted to be involved with this lecture series, which I hope you found useful, those of you that have been attending the series. What we're going to do today is the usual format. The speaker will present for 30 minutes or so, and that will be on the record, it'll be filmed. And afterwards, the Q&A session will be under the Chatham House rule, which, as you know, you may use the material in the Q&A, but you may not attribute it to this house or to any person who's here in the room. We'll try to finish up 2 o'clock or just very shortly afterwards. And can I please ask you to put your mobile phones on silent, and those of you that wish to tweet, the tag is at IIEA. So I suppose about the energy transition, Nikos, it's very important to us to understand the transition. And when we talk about the transition, it's always important to know where the destination is. And you and EITP SNET have contributed this piece of work, a vision for 2050. Involving 200 stakeholders in Brussels over, 2-3 years, and you built on the 2020 vision that also was produced by the same platform. I've looked at the vision and I've counted up 7 or 8 adjectives in it, and some concepts around circular economy and some concepts around Europe being a continuing leader in the world energy industry. So we'd be very interested to hear your talk, and you're most welcome to the Institute.
Thank you very much, Fergal. Allow me to stand because, being Greek, I think I like to do my hands more.
So, thank you very much. I would like to thank the Institute for its invitation. I'm very glad to be in Dublin and speak to Yamoni to speak with this group. So, what I'm going to present is the vision of ETIP SNET for 2050, and just to bring things into context. Let me summarize what has been the European Research and Innovation Energy Crisis. So, 2008, the SET plan was announced. It's a strategic energy technology plan that has set these famous 2020 goals of 20% greenhouse gas emissions, 20% renewable energy in private production, and 20% in energy efficiency. And then in 2014, there was an integrated roadmap that spoke about individual technologies, then put even higher targets of 40% reduction in greenhouse gas emissions, 27% renewable energy, and 27% energy efficiency. And that also provides several policy challenges. And currently we have the famous energy union priorities, what is called the winter package, that also puts new targets and new regulations, and there is now an ongoing discussion about this. And just in 2016, the ETIP SNET was formed. ETIP SNET, the European Technology Innovation Platform of Smart Networks for Energy Transition. And in fact, this was a result of unification of previous fragmented initiatives for advisory bodies and initiatives from Europe. Basically, there were two groups. It was the Smart Grids European Technology Platform, speaking about electricity networks, and then the EGI, which was an effort of the TSOs and DSOs to show the way, let's say, to help the Commission for the energy transition regarding networks. So these activities were unified to ETIP SNET, it was formed in 2016, and the idea was now to have a new focus on innovation implementation, and mainly on sector coupling. So it's not only in our electricity networks, but in all kinds of networks, also gas and liquid fuels, thermal, and so it's beyond smart electricity grids. We speak about the whole energy system. The mission of ETIP SNET is to set out the vision for the research, development, innovation for smart networks, and then engage stakeholders in this vision, to prepare and update the strategic research innovation roadmap, to report on the activities at European, national and industrial levels, and regarding set plan, to provide input to the set plan action form, which is related to energy networks and mainly the flexibility of energy networks. So how the system can work with very high penetration of renewable energies. Identify innovation barriers, develop knowledge sharing mechanisms to help bring results to deployment. And the last point is the, perhaps the unique feature of ETIP SNET is to provide a consolidated stakeholder view. So that's important because ETIP SNET for the first time consolidates the views of all stakeholders that deal with energy. And these are TSOs, distribution operators, DSOs, distribution operators, national representatives, so we have also members representing various nationals, various nations from Europe, research and academia, storage, both technology and service providers, consumers, aggregated and also individual organizations, thermal generation, here we speak about flexible generation, so this is how to help the system operate with very high penetration. We are not interested in the large thermal units, but in the thermal generation that is flexible to help the system operate. Renewable sources generation, again, how renewable also can provide flexibility by being controlled or provide services. ICP, both network and software providers, equipment manufacturers and suppliers, the big manufacturers, and the interface to other energy carriers, and you also have some from regulators. So everybody is in this organization, and what is important is that we are trying to provide consolidated views. And it's very difficult to provide a meaningful view that has been agreed by all these actors. It's a lot of discussions and a lot of exchanges and concessions. How it is organized? There is a governing board that is also the European Commission is there always. It's 30 members plus representing the all these stakeholders. We have an executive committee of 9 members. And then we have a national stakeholders coordination. So the national stakeholders, not all nations of European Union participate, but there are some representative members, persons. And then we have an expert coordination via 5 permanent working groups. And all this is assisted by the ETIP SNET Secretariat, which is funded by the Intensives for EU project. So it's a European project that funds the organization, the secretarial support of all this organization. But the actual work is done in the 5 working groups that are, the working group 1 speaks about reliable economic and efficient smart grid system. It's about the grid system, okay, the system. And then working group 2 speaks about storage technologies and sector interfaces. Working group 3 about flexible generation, both thermal and renewable. Working group 4 about stabilization of customers. And working group 5 about innovation implementation, so how we can bring the outcomes, the main outcomes of research into industry, into business environment. And there's a group that coordinates the national stakeholders. So in a few words, this is perhaps an important working group that sets the priorities, the requirements of the system. So that's mainly chaired by TSOs or DSOs. And then you have these 3 flexibility resources, which is storage, flexible generation, and active consumers. facilitated by digitalization. We have this working group that tries to bring research outcomes to the product environment. We have the national stakeholders group that provides what is done with national funding, so this is coordinated. So in fact, where we are at the moment, as I said, we were formed in 2016. Now we are in June 2018, we have published the vision 2050. This is what I'm going to talk to you about today. Then at the moment we work on the 10-year roadmap, because this is just a vision, you see, it's not, you won't get many answers, you just, we see a vision. But then we must see what steps we have to take to realize the vision. So this is done now next for the European, through the 10-year roadmaps, the implementation plan that is dividing that in 3-year periods, and all this will be provide as input to Horizon Europe. And in fact, Horizon Europe is very heavily influenced by the recommendation of this. So if you look at Horizon, the previous working program, you see that there was a lot of influence from the European Technology Platform, Smart Grids. Now we think that the ETIP SNET will be the provider main input of what should be done regarding certain innovation in Horizon Europe. So the goals are the what we always have said for many years, which is affordable energy through market-based mechanisms, security, resilience, reliable supply, and environment. These are the three main pillars. They remain the same also in this current vision. And in fact, what is the main, let's say, idea from the current system, that you have little renewable inputs, mainly fossil fuels and raw materials, low circularity, low recycling, small-scale CO2 capture, inefficient conversion, so the result is high CO2 emissions, high waste generation, to come into an integrated, digitalized energy system, efficient system with renewable resources as input, almost full circularity, little waste, little CO2 emissions, recycled materials and CO2 capture and use. That's the dream. And let me come to the vision. Okay. So we speak about a low carbon, secure, reliable, resilient, accessible, cost efficient, market-based pan-European integrated energy system, supplying the economy for a fully CO2 neutral circular economy by 2050. And that's perhaps new, the other was also more or less discussed before, maintaining and extending the global European industrial leadership in the systems. So also we need to see how Europe maintains its leadership currently in whatever it has, or also expanding this leadership, and also during the energy transition 2050. Okay, this is the pictorial that summarizes really all this vision. That looks like Dublin. It has the port and the airport and everything in the right places. So it's very much inspired by Dublin. So in all these small boxes, there are elements of this vision. I know you can't read them, but just let me describe them. So in fact, we speak about a system with a variety of generation sources, both centralized and decentralized, so both large thermal, large stations and also distributed generation, distributed sources. And these are fully or largely circular. So what you see here is mainly renewables, to a very large extent renewables. You see no coal, no gas. There is little nuclear, and that was a lot of discussions about nuclear. It should be here or not. It's not our vision, but several countries insisted that by 2050 nuclear will not be wiped out anyway. So it's and necessary evil that nuclear will be still here. And even liquid fuels will have been replaced by synthetic fuels or fuels generated by renewable energies. So we will have a fully or largely circular production system where the customer will be fully engaged. So if you see here, you see zero energy buildings, smart cities, renewable communities, peer-to-peer energy tradings, heat pumps, solar thermal generation, rooftop solar, energy communities, all the various resources, distributed resources. Multiple forms of storage, not only electrical storage through batteries and through reversible hydros, pumped hydros, but also storage in gas networks, storage in liquid fuels, all forms of storage. And this is a particular emphasis put in storage in this region. So that's, for instance, how today the electricity market works. So we have dispatchable non-renewable. We have dispatchable renewable and variable renewables, which is wind, solar, etc., and the demand. And in the future, you have an automated value-based storage conversion, where, of course, the peaks are covered by stored energy, and from your surplus, you store the energy, etc., so you have a more efficient system. And you have conversion technologies, widely used, all forms of conversion technologies, power to gas, gas to power and heat through these technologies. We have power to liquid, power to heat, that's of course common today. So we have all forms of conversion technologies. So you have a system, you have networks that exploit all the flexibility provided by the other networks. Okay? Fully integrated networks. Electricity, heating and cooling, gas and data. And a lot of initialization. To make all this system work, you need, of course, initialization. You need exchange of data. You need exploitation of the data in all forms to provide logistics that help the system operate efficiently. And again, all forms of wireless communication, wired communication, all technologies are exploited to the best. So now let's look at the building blocks of the vision. In all this activity, customers are supposed to be in the center. They have the central role of how the system will operate. So there are three basic ingredients that have been identified. One is markets. And markets will enable price-based coordination, so based on the various forms of renewable generation with no subsidies anymore, you will allow a system that is efficient, exploiting the renewables with market rules. You will have an optimal use of renewables, whether on demand across Europe, so you will enable diverse use of resources. Biomass synthetic gas will enable end use value for industrial process and also for houses, also for aviation and for shipping and long distance tracking. And as I said, storage will be also taken full advantage from seasonal to hourly variations. Digitalization and communication is the second important ingredient. You will have information with technologies like Internet of Things that will exploit the wide installation of smart meters and sensors to the network. So this will provide all the data for real-time monitoring and control, all the information needed, not only from the sensors, but also from other activities that they happen in our society. You will hear analytics, so data mining, machine learning and digital twins. You will have all the information or the data will transform into information used for the operation of the network. And massive connectivity and massive data exchange through machine to machine and all these widely interconnected machines in the system. And finally, you will have the integration and the collaboration with the customer and the physical system. And by that I mean cooperation between TSOs and DSOs, because as you know now, flexibility is very important to operate the network. So you need the flexibility not only from the connected networks, electricity, gas and heat and buildings, etc., but you also need to have a close collaboration between TSOs and DSOs. And in fact, as system develop and more renewables are connected, the flexibility is displaced. So thermal generators at the transmission level are displaced gradually by renewable generation, which need more flexibility. And naturally, flexibility resources now exist more and more at distribution level, where you have most distributed generation connected, you have more active customers connected, electric vehicles, etc. These are flexibility resources, and it's an ongoing discussion how this will be exploited by TSOs or DSOs or by collaboration. There are several models that can help both balances and also congestion, dealing with congestion in the system. Subsidiarity is another important concept, which means that systems must exploit, must rely as much as possible to the local optimization of the system, and should bring the problem in the higher levels when they cannot deal with it locally. So again, the ideas of microgrids, the ideas of local energy communities, all this is thought of taking an important role in the future. And finally, automation. I mean, you see now the system is highly automated, not of course 100%, you only need operators, but more and more automation and automated services and remote control, etc., will be installed in the system, as well as equipment now that are more based on flexibility provided by power electronics, by fast systems, and all these new developments. So that's another picture of how the future integrated systems will look like. So you have here a generation that is provided mainly by renewable electricity, also renewable electricity and heat, renewable heating and cooling, renewable gas, renewable fuel. And you see here the consumption, which is noted by two way arrows, which means the concept of prosumer, who not only consumes but also produces electricity. Everywhere, households, in tertiary sector, in industry, in agriculture, and you see a much more wide role of electricity in the electrification of ground transport, marine aviation. So you have this new change also in the electric energy consumption. In the middle are the networks. So you have the gas networks, the thermal networks, and the liquid fuel networks that are interconnected through local conversion technologies. You have gas storage, heating and cooling, and you have storage also, gas storage, heating and cooling storage, and the main electricity storage through batteries and hydros. You have all the interconnect, all the conversion technologies, gas to heat, gas to power, power to heat, power to gas, power to heat, etc. So that's how the system will look like, and the electricity networks is the backbone of this system. is the most important versatile type of networks that can make all the system operate. So electricity networks is the backbone of the grid energy system, and you see all these other energy networks being interlinked and supporting each other regarding the flexibility of the system. So the framework to operate on that is, as I mentioned before, European leadership in the world economy. Already Europeans are quite advanced in some aspects. For instance, in standards, there are some good, there's some leadership in standards, there's some leadership in other fields. So this needs to be strengthened and expanded. All these new technologies will bring economic disruption and job creation, so we need also to take care of this and to see how new businesses will be formed, how education will be transformed, how we create new specialities, how also university curricula need to adapt to all these new challenges. We need also to think again about the governance funding and financing of research and innovation. There is the feeling that at the moment this is not done perhaps optimally. There needs to be more effort on how to bring results of research into product development, to make more use of what's created in the European projects. And it is important to also to, the last message, say that we need to act today. We need to bring stakeholders together, we need to guide paths, link platforms, stakeholders, communication benefits, because if we don't do it today, the time is passing very fast and Europe will be left behind. And so that's my talk. Thank you very much for your attention.